Right. Good morning, everyone. And welcome virtually to Rushmere Baptist Church. I don't remember when it was last year. That was before you did your renovation. And I must admit, when I came in first, I couldn't work my way around what was what. And Neil kindly showed me around. So, thank you. And since we were last year, we've had a little girl called Gracie. Gracie's 2 years now, almost 2 years. She'll be 2 years in April. So thank you for inviting me to be here. I'm going to start with a prayer, if that's okay. My name is Sylvester, by the way. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you so much for this day. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your grace and your mercies, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that your love endures, Lord. And thank you that you love us just the way we are, Lord. We thank you. Lord, we pray that you would be in this meeting today, that you will have your way and that your will be done. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. I have a few questions I'd like you to perhaps think about. And when we break into the coffee groups, we could see who has the best answer. So the first one, if you're ready, you can grab a pen and paper and write this down and see who comes up with the best answers. So the first one is, why didn't they play cards on the ark? Why didn't they play cards on the ark? The second one is, why didn't Noah ever go fishing? Oh, I like this one. It says, what kind of man was Boaz before he married Ruth? And the fourth one is, where was Solomon's temple? Well, I must say, this sounds funny in my head. So if the answers are not funny to you, I must apologize. But I thought I would slip these in here. Right. So we are going to start off by having an opening song, which is Open the Eyes of My Heart. And if the band is ready, they can lead us in that song.
I want to see you. shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy.
Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you that we come before you today. We give thanks for bringing us all together this week and praise you for your many blessings during these difficult times. We pray for safety this week during this bad weather. We continue to remember those who are affected by COVID-19. We give thanks for the life of Sir Captain Tom and how he inspired so many. And now we pray for his family and friends and all who grieve loved ones. We think of those struggling within our fellowship, those who struggle with COVID, illness and loneliness, and those struggling with the after effects of having the vaccine. We pray for Hazel and the deacons and the leadership teams during these times as we seek your will for the future. We also give thanks for the work of CYM. Thanks for their continuing work with their schools and children during lockdown. But we do remember those families and children struggling during lockdown, where there is tensions and abuse. We pray that they get the help they need. We give thanks that the vaccine rollout has gone well in this country, but we pray that the vaccine will be shared fairly throughout the whole world, among all the nations. We also pray for all who are persecuted throughout the world. We thank you for the work of Open Doors who support Christians who are persecuted. We ask for safety and guidance for their staff. Lord, we pray for our world. We pray for Myanmar, for peace and justice there, Lord. And also we pray for peace in Syria and Yemen. plus many other lands where there's conflict. But Sovereign Lord, we know that we can put trust you with all these things to your love and care, and we give you all the glory, honor, and praise to you, our God and Saviour. Amen. Now, if I'd like to say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
I'm reading from the NIV book. It is John 5, 1 to 15. The healing at the pool. Some time later, Jesus went up to Jerusalem for a feast of the Jews. Now there is in Jerusalem, near the sheep gate, a pool, which in Aramaic is called Bethesda, and which is surrounded by five covered colonnades. Here a great number of disabled people used to lie, the blind, the lame, the paralyzed. One who was there had been an invalid for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in this condition for a long time, he asked him, "Do you want to get well?" "Sir," the invalid replied, "I have no one to help me into the pool when the water is stirred. While I'm trying to get in, someone else goes down ahead of me." Then Jesus said to him, "Get up, pick up your mat and walk." At once the man was cured. He picked up his mat and walked. The day on which this took place was a Sabbath. And so the Jews said to the man who had been healed, "It is said the Sabbath, it is the Sabbath. The law forbids you to carry your mat." But he replied, "The man who made me well said to me, 'Pick up your mat and walk.'" So they asked him, "Who is this fellow who told you to pick it up and walk?" The man who was healed had no idea who it was, for Jesus had slipped away into the crowd that was there. Later, Jesus found him at the temple and said to him, "See, you are well again. Stop sinning, or something worse may happen to you." The man went away and told the Jews that it was Jesus who had made him well.
From the rising of the sun, when the day has just begun, all creation sings a song of praise. And when the night is closing in, I will hide beneath your wings, and I will put my trust in you always. Every power in earth and heaven knows your name. Every trial and every season you remain. So when troubled waters rise, on this rock I'll build my life, and I will put my trust in you always. Should I wander far from home to the far side of the sea, even then your hand will keep me safe. And from the depths of my despair, I will lift this broken prayer, and I will put my trust in you always.
Every power.
Every power in earth and heaven knows your name.
You have searched my heart.
You have searched my heart and loved me just the same. So when trouble waters rise, on this rock I'll build my life, and I will put my trust in you all.
all your promises are sure. All your promises are sure. You go behind me and before, and you surround me. I'm covered by your grace. And so forever all my days, I will lift this song of praise, that you are faithful, good in all your ways. All your promises, all your promises are sure. You go behind me and before, and you surround me. I'm covered by your grace. And so forever all my days, I will lift this song of praise, that you are faithful, good in all your ways. Every power in earth and heaven knows your name. You have searched my heart and loved me just the same. So when trouble waters rise, on this rock I'll build my life, and I will put my trust in you always. All your promises, 'cause all your promises are sure. You go behind me and before, and you surround me. I'm covered by your grace. And so forever all my days, I will lift this song of praise, for you are faithful, good in all your ways. All your promises, 'cause all your promises are sure. You go behind me and before, and you surround me. I'm covered by your grace. And so forever all my days, I will lift this song of praise, that you are faithful and good in all your ways.
Right. Thank you. I was just saying to Neil that it seems that you guys have really cracked this virtual church thing very well. So well done to everyone working behind the scenes to make this happen. So this morning, I'm sure most of us are familiar with the passage on the healing at the pool called Bethesda. And I trust that God would speak to all of us this morning through this scripture. And sometimes we can read scripture and not perhaps learn anything new from it, but as the scripture says, that the word of God is active, the word of God is living, the word of God is relevant even in this day, even if it was written however many years ago, it is still relevant today. And I have spoken on this particular part of scripture, this passage. I have spoken on this perhaps a couple of times, and each time I look at this passage, I learn something new, and I trust that we would all learn something new from today. In reading this scripture, one of the things that excites me is about the fact that there was never a dull moment with Jesus. Imagine walking with Jesus in his time. There was never a dull moment. You know, if he showed up at the funeral, the dead man comes back alive. If he had people out with him in the desert, he somehow managed to feed them with very little food. If his friends left him on a boat, You know, if his friends went away and left him on a mountain on a boat, he comes walking on the water to his friends. If he sees a blind beggar by the side of the road, he restores his sight. I think it was just amazing to walk with Jesus in his time. And could we say the same about ourselves today, that in our walk with Jesus, are we finding it exciting every day? I believe that there were people who actually followed Jesus, not because of what he had to say or who he was, but perhaps because of the drama and the exciting things that always went with him, that perhaps they followed Jesus. And we learn today that Jesus goes to this place called the Pool of Healing, Bethesda. And there were all sorts of people around that pool. But our attention is drawn to one particular man whose name we do not know. But we are told that he had been in that condition for about 38 years. We also do not know how long he had been at this place, at Bethesda for. And so the interaction between this man and Jesus starts off by Jesus asking a very simple question. Do you want to get well? And on the surface of this, it seems to me that this question is perhaps not relevant. Because why would that man and many others in his situation be lying or being around that pool? I think we learn in verse 3 of the scripture that, you know, a great number of disabled people used to lie, the blind, the lame, the paralyzed. And if you would take notice of what your Bible, what your Bible says, you would find that it goes on from verse 3 to verse 5. And for some reason, there doesn't seem to be a verse 4 in that scripture. But then if you come down to the footnotes, it says that from time to time, an angel of the Lord would come down and stir up the waters. The first one into the pool after each such disturbance would be cured of whatever disease he had. So the reason why these guys were by the pool of Bethesda was so that they could be healed. So it would seem that Jesus' question perhaps was not necessary. And so this man finds himself pondering and contemplating on the question Jesus had asked him. And of all the many answers that he could have come up with, he rather chose not to answer the question directly, but said something that had perhaps no direct correlation with the question that was asked. And so, would it be possible that Jesus could ask you today, why are you a Christian? Or why are you part of Rushmere Baptist Church? Or why are you on a you know, part of a virtual church on a Sunday morning. So we learn from this scripture that the man answers Jesus and says, "Sir, I have no one to help me into the pool when the water is stirred. While I'm trying to get in, someone else goes down ahead of me." I'd like us to take a moment and put ourselves in the shoes of this man whose name we do not know. We do not know how long he'd been coming to the pool of Bethesda, but it would seem to me that he perhaps had been there for a while. And the fact that every now and then an angel of the Lord would stir up the water and someone would get healed. So he sits there and looks at that pool that holds the solution to his problem, but somehow can't seem to get out of the problem he's found himself in. And so it happens that someone else gets what could have been his. Someone else experiences what could have been his experience. And yet still, he shows up every day, hoping that it may become his turn one day. But the reality is that there isn't a chance that he would ever get his healing by that pool, because there are so many factors standing in his way of getting his healing. And if we were to look at these factors objectively, he doesn't stand a chance of getting healed. And yet still, he shows up every day to this place. He stays there. And so you may ask, what's the relevance of this scripture to us? If we go back to some of these irrelevant questions that we sometimes have to ask ourselves, why are we in church? Why are we Christians? Why do we have the same issues we've had for decades? Why have we not been touched by the power of Calvary? Why have our lives not been affected by the power that is at work in Jesus Christ? Why do we come forward every single day to get prayed for the same problem and have no solution to these problems? And if we were to go a bit deeper into our own personal lives, we would perhaps find that there are issues we have been dealing with for years and years that haven't been solved. And so it may perhaps be reasonable to ask, why not just forget about it and just leave and just move on? What's all this Christian business, Jesus Christ, church, Baptist, Anglican, Catholic? What's all this about? If my life is no different from the other person who has no relationship with Jesus Christ? Why have I been hoping for many, many years that Jesus would touch me and heal and restore a defect in me? A dysfunction in me, in our families, in ourselves, in, you know, let's not get into the details of it, but perhaps you know exactly what these issues are. And so is it possible that we may be in church, we may have we may be Christians, but our lives haven't been affected or touched the least by Jesus's power? And let's just look at this interaction here, that Jesus says, do you want to get well? And this man finds himself in the middle somehow, Jesus on one side and the pool of Bethesda on the other side. Now, he doesn't know who Jesus was. At that time, he didn't know who Jesus was. And so whilst he was contemplating this question about whether he wants to get well, his focus shifts to the pool. He's still looking at that pool and saying to Jesus that, I have no one to help me. So he sees the solution to his problem in the pool, which he had been around for a long time. And perhaps what Jesus introduces to us here is maybe to start to think about where our focus is, even in these times. And I believe that Jesus was trying to get his attention to himself, to him. But this man's focus was on the pool. But somehow, when Jesus responds to this man's comment, he says the most impractical thing to this man. He says, get up, pick up your mat and walk. Do you want to get well? Get up, pick up your mat and walk. And I'd like us to just spend a few moments on this interaction here as well. Jesus saying to the man to get up, knowing very well that this man is paralyzed. This man, it's impossible for this man to get up, to even think of him picking up his mat and to walk. And yet still Jesus demands of him the impossible. And so I just kind of see this almost like a mini standoff between the man and Jesus. So in my mind, I'm seeing Jesus standing, perhaps looking over this man and saying to him, get up. And it may be possible that Jesus had an outstretched hand, saying and, you know, encouraging him to get up. But could it be possible that in this time there was a little bit of disconnect between the expectations of Jesus and the expectation of the man? So this is a man who is always looked up to something coming up down to his level. And this is Jesus looking down to this man to rise up from where he was. And perhaps this man thinking, do I get up or do I just stay where I am? But then we learn that at once the man was cured. He picked up his mat and he walked. So it stands to reason that this man somehow made an effort to rise up. Somehow, tried to. And in the process of responding to Jesus' instruction, got his healing. And is it possible today that whatever situation you find yourself in, whatever the situation, whatever the problem, the very thing you think you cannot do, is it possible that Jesus is saying to you, do the very thing you think is impossible, you think you cannot do? And what's our response going to be to what Jesus is speaking to you and talking to you about today? And as this man turned his focus from the pool to Jesus, could it be possible that Jesus is inviting us to turn our focus from church as we know it and focus on him and him alone? I know this sounds very basic, but I think it's important that we ask ourselves these very questions. That is our focus on the pool of Bethesda, or is our focus on Jesus and responding to what he says or what he asks of us? One thing we learn from this passage is the man's obedience to Jesus' instruction. Are we obedient to what Jesus is saying to us? It's not enough to turn our focus to Jesus, and it's not enough to just focus on him, but it makes a difference if we respond to his instructions to us, if we obey what he asks us to do. I know things like this, perhaps in these our times, are not very, we're not maybe used to obeying what Jesus asks of us. Obey what Jesus asks of you. No questions asked. He's asking the impossible, but let's still respond to it. Just going to leave a moment for you to think about these questions. And in that time, we are going to sing our next song, which is Raise a Hallelujah. And as this song goes on, I'd like you to think and ponder and contemplate on what Jesus is asking you to do today.
Hallelujah, with everything inside of me. Sing a little louder.
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 Going to say the blessing in a minute, but just want us to take a couple of minutes and just respond to this. As we were worshiping, it's this picture of this man who, if you look at that story, he knew the ins and outs of the pool of Bethesda. He knew all about how it worked, but he didn't know Christ. He didn't know the source of that power. He didn't. And so as Jesus walked into that place and spoke to one particular man, could it be possible that Jesus is speaking to one particular person this morning? That you know all about church. You know how the service works. You know the language. You know the behavior. You know what you have to do in church. But you don't know on a personal level the source of power. You don't know Jesus on a personal level. And as Jesus invited this man to know him, he's extending that invitation to you this morning. If you are listening to me and you know you do not know Jesus, you do not have a personal relationship with him, I'd like to encourage you to just respond to Jesus' invitation. And if you would like to take that step, perhaps I can just pray with you briefly now. And you can say this in your heart. You can say this aloud. Say, dear Jesus, thank you that you came in search of me today. Thank you that your love for me meant that you died on a cross, a shameful death. Thank you that you're inviting me to share the abundance of life that you only can give. And so I invite you into my heart today to be my Lord and my personal Savior. Thank you, Lord. I renounce all my sins and I accept your forgiveness and your grace this day. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. I'm just going to read the blessing over us, and so I'll just encourage us to close our eyes in this moment. The Lord bless and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. Thank you. And so we are going to break into the coffee mornings, and we will talk about the quiz I started off this before the sermon. So yeah, it'll be good to see all of you. Yeah. Thank you. Bye.